closed, no more cabaret shows. Every theater nerd is home thinking this really blows. But the Metzger-Timsons have the answer for you. Trivia with a star or two.
They've got multiple choice and name that voice.
When the guest stars sing, everyone will rejoice.
So grab a drink,
turn your brain on and think. It's MT Trivia with the MT. Hello!
Hello! Hello! Hello! Happy Monday!
Welcome to MT Trivia.
I'm Kevin MT.
I'm Chris MT.
Welcome. If this is your first time here, we're glad to have you. We're going to need you to play along. So throw your, say hello in the comments, throw your answers in the comments. We'll get there. I'm jumping the gun.
You're jumping the gun. We just want to know you're here. So shoot us a waving emoji in the comments. Let us know you're here. We're so happy you're here. And if you're having fun, subscribe to Broadway Talk Live Nowhere.
Woo!
It's
February.
It is.
It's still February. It was February last week.
We're still going strong. It is Black History Month, and we are raising some money for very important organizations this month. And this week's is Broadway for Racial Justice.
It sure is. Broadway for Racial Justice is fighting for racial justice and equity by providing immediate resources, assistance, and amplification for BIPOC actors and community members in the Broadway and theatrical community at large. And in doing so, they hope to create safe spaces throughout the theater community for creativity and artistry to thrive.
Yes. So we're really happy to be raising some money for them. If you're having fun tonight, there's two ways you can donate. You can go to this website right here, or you can Venmo us at MT-Trivia, and we will donate 100% of those tips to Broadway for Racial Justice. So that's that. So I think without further ado, we should just dive right in because
we have a dreamboat of a cast for you tonight.
Oh my gosh, we are here with the triple threats of Broadway.
The Newsies are here.
The Newsies are here. We're ready to do some pirouettes on newspapers.
They're going
to
be carrying the banner.
Seize the day. Tell us about our first guest.
Are you talking about Mr. Adam Kaplan?
Yes.
Well, he made his Broadway debut in Newsies, which I saw him in multiple times, understudying the lead role of Jack Kelly and playing one of the spunky Newsies with a spunky name, which we'll ask him about when he shows up.
Because
they both have spunky names. He also then went on to play Calogero in A Bronx Tale.
Yes.
And was Charlie on the national tour of Kinky Boots.
That is the one and only Adam Kaplan. And then our next guest, we went to college together for many years. I've loved watching his career soar since he left the University of Cincinnati. He has been on Broadway in
literally every show ever.
Mary Poppins, Carousel, Matilda, Newsies. He was on the tour of Wicked and most recently played Ambrose Kemper on the national tour of Hello, Dolly, starring Betty Buckley.
I was going to say opposite Betty Buckley.
Starring, because Ambrose is definitely opposite Dolly in Hello, Dolly. It is the one and only Garett Hawe.
My name is Garett Hawe, and I play Albert in Newsies. Albert. Yes.
A brand new, fresh-faced leading man, Adam Kaplan, previously seen in the ensemble of Newsies and on tour as Charlie Price in Kinky Boots, is gearing up to headline A Bronx Tale.
In a world like this, where everything seems black and white. In a world like this, they're so quick to tell you what's wrong and what's right. Well, let them talk, talk, talk. Who cares what they say? Now that you're here, well, it's clearer than day that
just be real is all I'm asking. Not some painting in my head.
'cause I'm dead if I can't count on you today.
Oh my God.
Greatest hits.
Garett and I were texting each other that
whole time. I am dead that you guys pulled that footage from that Broadway Loves Britney concert. Circus.
It's the best thing I've ever seen.
Maybe.
It was a must.
We are at Joe's Pub and it's like literally no room on that stage, and we had like had to do choreography, and in that clip like you can see me like hit the like one of the band members and I'm like sorry.
My favorite part was, hi, I'm Garett Hawe and I play Albert.
It was just the pivotal role,
the coveted role,
the coveted role. Yeah, Albert. So Garett, you were Albert in Newsies, and Adam, what was your newsie name?
I was Mike. But I was also, Morris Delancey, and I was Mike.
Yes. More. I thought all the newsies had like Crutch, Spot,
Skippy. They all are like peanut butter names.
Jeff.
They did, but the other, it was Morris and Oscar Delancey, and then their like newsie names were Mike and Ike. So like we were Mike.
Oh, that's cute. All right. It's cute when they're together, when you separate them.
Right.
I'm Mike.
Well, you two are just cute as a button. Those were a really fun, that was a really fun trip down memory lane. So thank you. Welcome to the show. How are you both? Where are you coming to us from?
I am here in New York City on the Upper West Side. I was in New Hampshire at my family's house for a lot of last summer, but I'm here back in the city and happy to be here.
Woo! Yes, just a few blocks away. Adam? Yeah.
I've been bouncing back and forth between my parents in Connecticut, which is where I am right now, and New York.
Hi, Mom and Dad.
I don't know what they're doing. That was like, I have to go. I like a little dinner. I was like, oh shit, I have to go. So,
fun fact: Adam always hosted the 4th of July parties at his house in Connecticut, and they were epic. So fun.
Yes, I've seen the Andrew Keenan Bulger video montage of that party.
Mm-hmm. Where I think you didn't, Garett, didn't you push JP in the pool? Wasn't that you in the video, like pushing him in the pool?
Yes.
Well, yeah. I've missed out. I'm going to have to look this up immediately. Just give me, I'll be right back.
Well, we're thrilled to have you. We have three rounds of musical theater trivia coming your way. I hope you both paid attention in college and history of musical theater 101.
You got to make Aubrey proud, Garett.
I'm going to try. I'm going to make no promises.
Without further ado, let's bring in our first round, which we like to call
A Simple Choice.
A simple choice. Nothing more. This or that. Either or.
So as you may have guessed, this is the multiple choice portion of the evening, and we like to theme all of our rounds towards our guests. And since you both starred in the hit Broadway musical Newsies, and then Adam, since you went on to star in A Bronx Tale, we are giving you a little Alan Menken round of MT trivia today. So all these questions will be about Alan Menken.
And you at home, we need you to play along as well. So throw your answers into the comments so you can help these boys out. Because listen, we dug deep and we went
and
hard.
We're going to need your help. And boys, just so you know, the audience is on like a 15-second delay. So, you know, as we ask the question, feel free to banter. We're going to discuss your thought process. I will ask for a final answer before it counts. All right. So let's just jump right in. We're going to talk about Alan Menken. He met his first major collaborator, the great Howard Ashman, at the BMI workshop. What was their first fully produced collaboration together? Was it Little Shop of Horrors, Smile, God Bless You, Mr. Rosewater, Weird Romance, or The Little Mermaid?
Okay, I think I know the answer to this because during Newsies, we did a, they were like doing a test reading of this to figure out whether or not this show could, you know, be reproduced. And so I think I know the answer. But am I supposed to say it now?
I mean,
yes.
Garett, do you think you know, or are you totally in the dark?
I mean, I think I know what Adam's talking about. So I think I know the answer, but I have like a backup.
Let's see what the audience is saying.
We've got a couple little Shop of Horrors.
We've got some C's.
Some God Bless You, Mr. Rosewater.
Someone watched the documentary. The Howard Ashman documentary is excellent if you haven't seen it. All right. I guess we'll go for it. Let's see what you're thinking. Garett, we'll start with you since you're a little less sure. What is your
answer? I'm going to say C. God Bless You, Mr. Rosewater.
Adam?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying too.
Yes, that is correct. God Bless You, Mr. Rosewater was the first collaboration produced between the two men. They later, their first hit was Little Shop of Horrors. So those of you in the audience who thought that was the answer, that was not far off. Smile was actually Howard Ashman and Marvin Hamlisch.
Yes.
And Weird Romance is...
Weird.
Is weird. And was that what it is? Weird Romance?
Yeah.
We lost it. That was Alan Menken and...
Did you sing
David Spencer.
Disneyland from Smile? I feel like that's something you would have sung in college.
You know, I probably did at some point.
I think I probably heard you actually sing that.
Song. Oh, a classic. Well done, boys. All right, so we're going to move on to that Little Shop of Horrors. It's Alan Menken and Howard Ashman's 1982 adaptation of the low-budget 1960 black comedy of the same name. When comparing the original movie to the musical, now this is the non-musical 1960 movie.
Not the smash hit movie adaptation of the musical starring Rick Moranis and Alan Green.
No, we're talking the OG movie. When you're comparing this to the musicale, which of these statements is not true? All right, so we're looking for the false statement. So, choice A, Seymour has a hypochondriac mother in the film, but he is an orphan in the musical. In the film, Seymour is eaten by the plant rescuing Audrey, while in the musical, he feeds himself to the plant, attempting to kill the plant from the inside. Choice C, the film has a subplot involving two investigative police officers. Choice D, Mushnick and Audrey survive in the film. Or E, the plant is named Audrey Jr. in the film and Audrey 2 in the musicale. Which of these statements did I make up?
Oh, I literally have no idea. I've never seen it.
Well, I've never seen them. You've never like seen the musical. Or you've never seen.
No, I've never seen this 1960 movie adaptation.
I feel like I only saw clips of it in the Howard Ashman documentary.
Definitely feature it. I did watch it as a kid and I did not remember it. I had to like research this question, but it's definitely worth a watch. It's funny stuff.
I think I'll go with E. That feels like Audrey Jr.
All right, okay.
Audrey, everyone's going D.
I'm going with D. I'm going with the audience.
Okay. You're with the audience. And so Garett, you're going with Z, and Adam, you're going with
I'm going with E.
E? Well, to the both of you, I'm going to have to say...
Hell no!
Oh, no!
The correct answer is choice B, which is in the film and in the film and the show.
Yes,
Seymour. He is killed trying to kill the plant from the inside. So that's not a difference. It's the same in both adaptations. He does have a hypochondriac mother in the original film, and there is these like two like police officers like trying to solve the mystery in the film. It's like a whole subplot there. So there, and it is Audrey Jr. in the original film.
I was
hilarious.
I would just like to bring up the travesty that is the change for the movie musical in which Audrey, spoiler alert,
if you've never seen it, close your ears.
In which Audrey survives.
Yeah.
She can't survive.
Audrey's
gotta die.
Audrey surviving in the movie. I know. They filmed the original ending where they both die and then they
test audiences didn't test like audience it. Blah, didn't blah, like blah.
It was too dark.
Yeah, let's leave major musical theater plots to Karen's from Wisconsin.
They wanted a happy ending.
No offense to Karen's from Wisconsin.
They wanted a happy ending and they got it, but it's an excellent movie. Both of the movies are great. Go check it out. All right,
we already did this one.
We already did this one, honey.
Oh, I went the wrong way.
Okay, so now we're going to talk about another Menken and Ashman classic, Beauty and the Beast. It's the 10th longest running show in Broadway history. It was nominated for 9 Tony Awards, but was only awarded 1. This is in the 1994 Tony Awards. Which award did the musical take home? Was it Best Musical, Best Original Score, Best Direction of a Musical, Best Costume Design, or Best Leading Actress for Ms. Susan Egan?
I think I know this one. I'm going to say D, Best Costume Design.
Okay.
I might be wrong, but it should have. Those costumes were incredible.
They are fierce. I agree.
I think I'm going to say D, too.
We're going D?
Yeah, we're going D. We're going D.
Audiences with some Ds as well. The costume work is divine. All right. Well, boys, I'm going to have to say to you. Yes, it won for Best Costume Design. And unbelievably did not win the other 8 nominations that it got, including Ms. Queen Susan Egan.
The fact that it got as many Tony nominations as it did, when the whole entire Broadway community in New York was like, how dare Disney come to Broadway, and was like so anti it, is amazing.
Yeah, it's true.
And also,
it got a lot of flack.
Do love the like added plot point in the musical of how the enchanted objects like turn more into the objects as the show goes on. And so like their costumes become like, they evolve and they become like less human and more, it's like the whole bit with Cogsworth turning around and he has like the screw in his back.
Are they reviving it soon?
I think they are reviving it.
They've been talking about it. Yeah.
Do you know which song they added in mid-run?
A Change in Me.
Oh, Adam, are you turning the tables on?
Oh, do I know?
Did you sing that? It's CCM too.
Yeah, Garett, was that in your book at CCM?
It was, and I did the Ashley Brown ending too.
Obviously, the Ashley Brown.
If you're at CCM, you have to do the Ashley Brown ending.
It's requirement.
Where she takes it up at the end, obviously. A Change in Me was added for Ms. Toni Braxton when she took over for Belle.
Yep.
She demanded that they write her song. And legend has it that Alan Menken was a little tipsy when he agreed to that. Maybe regretted it afterwards, but he wrote a great song. So
great.
Yeah.
Does that bring us?
I think that
no.
It does not. We have one more question.
Oh, we do.
I'm sure. All right, everyone. So our next multiple choice question. Which of the following was one of the advertising taglines for The Little Mermaid on Broadway? So I'm going to put Little Mermaid before each one because it's more dramatic that way. The Little Mermaid. The hardest part of falling in love is taking the first step. The Little Mermaid. Somewhere under the sea and beyond your imagination is an adventure in fantasy. The Little Mermaid. Out of the sea and onto the stage. The Little Mermaid. Fun for the whole family. Or The Little Mermaid, a Disney favorite making a splash on Broadway.
Some of these sound like the taglines for the Little Mermaid journey to the voyage. What's the thing show?
Listen, Disney, if you're hiring, I'm unemployed. So
voyage to the, what's the voyage of the Little Mermaid? Yes.
Voyage under the sea or something.
Yes, I'm sorry though. Exactly. I don't know if you booked it with these taglines. I feel like it's gotta be E. A Disney favorite is making a splash on Broadway.
That's right. What I would say too. With
what does our audience think? Do we have any? We've got an A.
Jackie Cox thinks A.
Yeah, like it could be A.
Or it could be
B. Isn't there a song? The hardest part of love is the letting go.
Different composer. We're not talking about him today. All right, boys. I guess I'm going to ask for your final answer. Is it E?
I'm going to say E, though I want to say Out of the Sea and Onto the Stage, because I do think that that's so much more fun, but I do think it's E.
I'm going to say E as well.
What was that you were saying about my taglines not being too good?
To be fair, when Chris quizzed me, I guessed E as well. It is a good tagline.
Thank you.
Chris, I apologize.
Yeah, you're welcome. You're welcome. The actual answer is the hardest part of falling in love is taking the first step on those 2 new feet you got. What do you call them? Feet.
We need to brush up on our Disney theatrical trivia.
I also like Out of the Sea and Onto the Stage. I think that's cute too.
That is cute.
I had some other flops that just didn't make the cut, but I'll see if I can think of them as we go. But this brings us to our Broadway bonus. All right. Broadway bonuses famously are not multiple choice, but we're still talking about The Little Mermaid here. The Little Mermaid.
The Little Mermaid.
It began.
The hardest part of falling in love is taking the first step. Go ahead.
The Little Mermaid began previews on November 3rd, 2007, and was slated to open on December 6th, but it did not actually open until January 10th, 2008. What caused this month-long delay?
I know this. Garett, do you know this?
I mean, I remember something, there was an accident, but I don't know if that's it.
With the Heelys?
No, it's not with the Heelys. No.
I don't think
it was. It was a very dramatic accident. And yeah.
Adam, I'll let you steal it since you were the first one.
This was the strike. Was it the stagehand union strike?
Yes, the Broadway stagehand strike of 2007. It was the second longest strike in Broadway history after the musician strike of 1975, which lasted for 25 days.
And was still shorter than the amount of time Broadway's been shut down because of the coronavirus pandemic. I hope you all enjoyed the Super Bowl last night.
Oh, honey. All right. Just things are getting a little heated here at MC Trivia. But
good job, Adam.
Thank you.
Good job, Adam. The stagehand strike, yeah, it shut down all of Broadway for a couple weeks. Little Mermaid was in preview, so it had to extend. And then it was like Christmas, and so they had to like push it past the holidays, and so it delayed it like a whole month.
Fortunately, no performers went off the front of the stage on their Heelys.
They did not.
I'm saying, fortunately,
correct.
No one.
Yes, fortunately,
it wasn't because of the Heelys.
But IATSE, it's a strong union. Am I right? All right. We've got one more question for you tonight, and that is about Aladdin. The score of the Broadway production of Aladdin features music by Alan Menken and lyrics by three different lyricists. So this is a little different from our other question.
Ooh,
it's a three-parter.
A new format.
Yeah. New format, welcome. We're trying it out tonight. So you're going to match the song on the left-hand side with the correct lyricist on the right-hand side. And I'm not going to say that it's necessarily one for one, but these are the three lyricists of Aladdin and three songs from Aladdin who wrote each song. Discuss. I'll give you a topic. Discuss.
Okay, I feel like three is definitely C, right?
Yes, 100%.
Okay. And then I feel like Proud of Your Boy is Howard Ashman because that was cut, right?
Yes, that's what I think too.
And then I think A Whole New World was also Howard. No, I feel like it was both, wasn't it?
I think it's also Howard Ashman. I don't think Tim Rice did anything with Aladdin. Did he?
Well, didn't they just say that like it was the...
I'm telling you, all three of them did write lyrics for Aladdin on Broadway.
Okay, never mind.
But I'm not saying that it's necessarily one of them for each of these songs. Do you know what I mean?
Right. I feel like...
No, but they're all credited.
I feel like Proud of Your Boy is Howard Ashman. Then I feel like A Whole New World probably is Howard Ashman too.
That's what I think.
Got some people in the audience have some good...
We got a 1B...
Got a 2A. We've got a 1B.
2A, 3C.
Oh my God. But then we've got a double A. You guys are saying a double A, C?
Yeah.
An AAC? You don't have to agree. You can also stand apart.
No, let's be unified on this.
I'm thinking 2A. 1A, 3C.
So you're going AAC.
Yeah.
Yes, final answer.
14G.
For both of you? Yeah. All right. Well, unfortunately, you're one off. A Whole New World was written by Mr. Tim Rice. And then Proud of Your Boy was originally written for the movie by Howard Ashman, who passed away in the middle of writing for the Aladdin movie, but it was cut from the movie and then reinstated into the musicale. And then Chad Beglin was brought on to write lyrics for all the new music that Alan Menken wrote for the Broadway musical. And he wrote behind these palace walls?
Beyond
these palace walls.
She wants to go beyond.
Behind, which of course,
like, I love that every version of Aladdin, they've written like a new song for Jasmine. Like the Disneyland theme park had the one song.
Yes.
Something about the birds.
Well,
and
Jasmine
the cages.
Didn't have a song in the movie.
I know. And then they gave her palace walls, and then the new movie gave her the Passick and Paul song.
Yes. What was that? I didn't see it. I missed
Speechless.
The movie,
waving Speechless. Through the window.
That's a good
And then they put Waving Through the Window in Aladdin. It was very...
It was so weird.
A strange choice. Yeah, Pasek and Paul wrote those lyrics.
They did. All right. Lyricists.
Look at Alan Menken being a collaborator and able to work with different lyricists.
I would
lyricists.
Say he is Broadway's ultimate collaborator. He's worked with Ms. Lynn Ahrens. He has worked with everybody. He's just... He's the best.
He's easygoing. Yeah.
You guys obviously met him when you were working on Newsies and Bronx Tale, right?
Is he just
the coolest guy?
Yeah. He was there the entire creative process from paper mill to opening on Broadway. I mean, every day he was there with like lyric rewrites and yeah, I mean, he was amazing. He was the nicest guy.
Yeah.
He's a dad.
Just the sweetest. Well, boys, that brings us to the end of our first round. I'm going to do some tallying of the score.
And I'm going to remind you that if you're having fun tonight and you'd like to tip us, maybe what you would spend on your 2-drink minimum at 54 Below or what you would tip Jackie Cox if you saw her at Rebar here in New York City. We are going to be giving 100% of our tips to Broadway for Racial Justice. So you can Venmo at MT-Trivia. You can also check out Broadway for Racial Justice at bfrj.org/donate. How are we looking, babe?
I think we're pretty neck and neck going into this round, you guys. I'm very impressed with your knowledge. And I'm impressed with Adam creating his own question. Well done. Bonus point to each of you for creating the question and getting it right. And we're moving into round two, which we like to call Name That Diva.
It's hard to be the diva. It's hard to be divine. To live the life of fever with your guts on the line. It's hard to be the diva. The stories I could tell. My life may seem like heaven, babe, but boy, is it hell.
All right.
I'm having a night. buttons aren't being pushed. So Name That Diva's famously our audio round. We are going to play you a short clip of a fierce Broadway singer, usually belting.
Yes,
and all you have to do is tell us who is singing.
And
tonight, Garett, you provided the inspiration for our Name That Diva because you've done a national tour of Hello Dolly, not once, but twice, starring fierce divas such as Sally Struthers and Betty Buckley. And you've played a smattering of roles from Barnaby Tucker to Ambrose Kemper. And I cannot wait to see Irene Malloy in the 2030 revival.
One day.
Oh my gosh, it would sound gorgeous.
Adam Kaplan as the front half of the horse that pulls Dolly onto the stage.
Yes.
Thank you. Coming from a casting director, it's very sweet to know my type.
At least he didn't make you the act.
I gave you the front half.
This is going to be Name That Dolly.
Oh yeah, I didn't say what the punchline was.
So we're going to be playing you some clips of famous Broadway women singing Hello Dolly, but they aren't necessarily like...
Former Dollies.
Yeah, well, they might have played it regionally, they might never have played but they're singing Dolly. But they are all world-renowned Broadway singers. And just so you know, a logistic thing, you guys, for this one.
Rules.
There's rules. There's always rules. So we can let the audience play along at home because of the delay. When you know the answer, put your hand up and say, I know it. And then whoever puts their hand up first, we will go to you when the clip is over to reveal the answer. But that way, if you're at home, as soon as you know it, put it in the chat so you get your answer in before we spoil it for you. Okay? And without further ado.
Down on this one.
Okay.
It's loud.
It's a little
loud. All right. Ready for our first clue?
Our first Dolly. Here she is, boys. We love a Dolly who options up.
Adam, I think I saw your hand first. Who is that Dolly, Levi?
I think the lady's improving Miss Beth level.
Yes, it is the one and only Beth level. I guessed Betty Buckley for the first 5 seconds when Kevin played that for me because it was like she was on my
Garett
mind.
Would know. He heard that he 8 shows a week.
Not Betty.
I know, but the first like 10 seconds really sounded like Betty and I was fooled. But then I saw the error of my ways.
She played it at the Muni, right? Beth level?
I believe so.
I think that's where she did it. Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Just such a star.
What a role for her.
Yes.
Truly.
She can keep doing it. She's going to do it
again. No, she's got years on her. All right. Here's our next clue. Our next Dolly.
All of those lights over there seem to be telling me where I'm going. When the whistles blow and the cymbals crash and the sparklers light the sky, I'm gonna raise the roof, I'm gonna carry on. Give me an old trombone, give me an old baton for the parade. That's it.
Yeah, we got a lot of answers. In
I love the like. That's such a Disney princess.
Yeah, right? Disney that. Princess Dolly.
these are all very good guesses, Alan but Lincoln. None of them are correct. It's not Miss Egan. It's not Miss Murphy. It's not Miss Foster. Adam.
Okay, Gare, I'll give you a clue.
Thank you.
He's gonna help out.
The pony kicked her here.
Oh my God! Is it okay?
Victoria. Oh my God.
When Carla was 10.
It was the one and only Victoria Clark.
I have to just say, since you brought up the pony that kicked her, someday I'll show you the clip. There are three boys from my musical theater college program who, for their final dance piece in like beginning ballet, their sophomore year, in which the entire program was invited to watch, they staged a ballet set to Carol of the Bells, in which they told the story of Clara being kicked in the head by the Shetland pony.
Broadway's
Larkin Bogan.
Is it one?
Christian Acey, who wrote our theme song, Holler At Ya. And who's the third?
He's not in the industry anymore.
Anyways,
recited Victoria Clark's monologue about the Shetland pony. It went into Carol the Bells, and they became the Shetland pony and became Clara.
It's so good. And these boys are like level one ballet.
It's good. I think it's so on good. YouTube. I'll send it to you.
It's so good. Please.
Also, really good. Larkin Bogan's a star, so like that makes sense.
Listen, if you had told me in that moment that I would one day see Larkin Bogan dancing in the ensemble of Wicked on Broadway, I would have laughed in your face. But, you know, here we are. He grew. Larkin, we love you.
We love you, Larkies.
Yes, that, of course, is Broadway's Tony Warning Victoria Clark in that beautiful arrangement. Moving right along to our next Dolly. Here we go.
I'm ready to move out in front. I've had enough of joys passing by life with the rest of them, with the best of them. I can hold my elbow. For I gotta go again, I gotta drive again. I'm gonna feel my heart coming alive again before the parade passes by.
All right, we're gonna give that one to Garett.
Okay, I wasn't sure, and then I saw it in the comments, and I was right. So, or at least I think I'm right. I think it's Adrian Warren.
Yes!
Dylan and Garett for the win.
Tina Turner herself, Adrian Warren.
Tony nominee.
Can I just say, I've heard that clip a lot over the past few days, and I would just like to put this out there in the universe and for all the Broadway producers and investors watching our show. Sideshow Revival starring Adrian Warren and Patina Miller. You cowards!
We need it immediately. Oh, am I right?
That would be incredible.
I guess Patina for the first like 15 seconds of that one. And
it is Patina. Yeah. Yes, that of course is future Tony winner Adrian Warren.
Yes. Amen, everybody. All right. So
you guys are doing good. Yes. We haven't stumped you yet, and this was hard. Here
Adam
we go.
Adam took the first two. This one was Garett.
Adam's two more. Kicking my butt, I think.
No, two. Listen. It's like
we got two more. It's anyone's game.
Here we go.
All those lights over there seem to be telling me where I'm going. When the whistles blow and the cymbals crash and the sparklers light the sky, I'm gonna raise the roof. I'm gonna carry on. Give me an old trombone. Give me an old baton. Before the parade. Before the parade.
One more.
I know that voice.
Yes,
I know
you do.
You do.
Yes, you do. Think Frank Wildhorn.
Yes. Okay, now I know it. Thank you.
You can say it together. One, two, three.
Linda Evans.
The original Broadway Belchess herself.
Yes, the one and only Linda Eder, her voice has famously been compared to Barbara Streisand's throughout her entire career, and Barbara obviously played Dolly in the movie. So she
did?
Had to cover the song, you know? She's done all of Barbara's greatest hits. We stand Linda Eder.
All right, one last one for you guys are killing this. I will say this one is niche. Oh my God, we love an option.
That arrangement is the winner for me. But.
That was so good.
Adam, did you raise your hand?
I did.
You had a tentative hand.
And now why am I blanking on her name? Okay.
Who were you thinking of? Like, from what?
Yeah, talk us through it.
Is it? Oh, it's Nikki M. James.
Yes! Yes, Tony winner, Nikki M. James. That's good, Adam.
Wow. I recognize that vibrato is so specific and so good, but I'd recognize that shit anyway.
It really is. That was niche. I'm very impressed, Adam. That was a really hard one.
You boys know you're probably divas.
Pearl Bailey, like
that's who I thought it was.
that's fair. Pearl Bailey was a much heavier tone.
Yeah, she had like a huskier, like Dolly, thank you for that.
You're welcome. Garett, did you do the show with Miss Carmelo?
I did. I had left the show by then. I heard she was amazing, though.
My gay claim to fame is that I saw all three Broadway dollies. And my goal was to see all of the tour dollies, but I missed it, unfortunately.
I didn't see, I saw Bernadette and Bette, but I didn't see Donna.
Yeah, me too.
I saw Donna and Bernadette's very first performance. I like a very first performance dolly. It's very dangerous. They don't know all the lines.
It's so good.
And they inevitably, there's something goes horribly wrong and I live for it. It makes me very nervous. I'm shaking the whole time and that's how I want to see Hello Dolly. I want the Dolly Levi to be when she is staring up at Ephraim. I want to see the terror in her eyes about what comes next. So if you ever do Hello Dolly, I will, if I can, I will be there your very first performance.
He'll go with you. Call on Kevin. He'll be there.
Donna Murphy dropped the cane on the passerelle during So Long Dearie, her first performance.
Bernadette and Victor Garber had to go back in a scene. Bernadette, and she was like, I'm in the wrong spot. I'm going to go back over here. Let's go back to that line. Here we go. It was like,
I mean, that role just never stops.
Never stops.
Props, costumes. There's so
that's
much.
Like the stuff, though, that like people live to see. Like you live to see Bette Midler like forget her lines and be like, all right, let's go again.
I would have given anything to have been in the audience the night that they miscalled the drop coming in and it crashed onto the... Did you hear the story about the... Okay, real fast. We have time. Bette Midler's on stage. It's like Bette Midler and Kate Baldwin and Beanie Feldstein. And they're all on stage in the dress shop. And they're getting ready to go into the transition where the whole set is like revolving and the drops coming in and they're going into dancing and they're leaving the shop and something got miscalled and the drop hit the dress shop and hit like a lighting fixture and it crashed And so there was shattering glass, and Bette Midler made the choice to just slow, 70-something-year-old Bette Midler, who's like, what, 4'11", makes the choice to just slowly crouch to the stage as the lights
she
are dimming.
Hits the floor.
And they had to hold the show. It was very dramatic. Oh, and everyone was okay, which is why we can laugh about it. But I just would have been given anything to be there to see Bette Midler just slowly crouching to the stage as it's like,
oh my God.
Remember when in the Tony Awards, when like the drop came too early and hit the guy who's
singing Rock of Ages.
Yes, that. But the gag of that was that he wasn't at the tech rehearsal. He had a stand-in, and so he was off his mark, which is why we out there, no matter how big of a star you are, you show up to dress rehearsal.
Do you hear that, Garett?
You heard it from us. Okay.
Garett, enough of sending your stand-in to the... All right.
My assistant was there.
I could tell Hello Dolly stories all night, but we don't have time because we've got to get to our last round, which is what, honey?
Well, we love to call it Sing Out, Louise.
Sing out, Louise.
Sing out, Louise.
Sing for me, my meadowlark. Sing for me of the silver morning.
We're just a little off our timing.
I've been up since 5:30 this morning, so that's what it's way past my bedtime.
Oh, thank you for being with us tonight.
Steve Edlin.
Oh my God, Steve Edlin, our
Steve. Oh my gosh.
Addison McCarthy, remember that. Addison, if you were in the audience, let me know.
So this is the part of the show where we put our guests to the work to work. We make them do all the work and sing for us, our angels of music. We have sent them 3 secret clips that they have not listened to before the show. And they are going to get a little bit of vocal, and then they just have to finish the clip. It's
simple.
It's simple. It's really, and boys.
It's like TikTok.
Yes, exactly.
And for us who are pushing 30.
Yeah, who don't know how that works. But boys, as we told you before, we encourage riffing, scatting, alternate lyrics, whatever you need to do to get through the song, you know? And it's more fun for us that way. So... We like to theme each round of this section. And historically, the first round is always songs from your past.
Ooh. Oh, no.
Oh, yeah.
So we like to go a little easy on you because at least you've sung the song before sometime in your life.
Who would like to go first?
I'll go.
All right, Garett, thanks for volunteering.
Thank you so much for volunteering.
This is going to be so bad. I do not ever remember lyrics.
I can't wait.
We can't wait. You're going to open the track labeled number 1.
Okay.
Are you ready?
Oh, God. Land, but it is fed and watered by God's almighty hand. He sends the snow in winter, the warmth to swell the grain. The breezes and the sunshine, the soft, refreshing rain. All good gifts around us are sent from heaven above. Then thank the Lord, oh, thank the Lord. For all his love. Is that it?
Yes!
Yeah. I can't believe I remember that.
You nailed it!
Dang, that 15 years ago in college.
Yes, Ooh. You did. I saw it with my very own eyes. And that's actually the same production. Ooh. We had Andrew Chappelle on the show a couple weeks ago, and we made him sing All for the Best.
Oh my God,
so
amazing.
Next week, we've got to have Eric Altimus on to do some Jesus material.
Who is your Jesus? It was also my Jesus when we did it in high school.
And so, Mia Gentile, who did Kinky Boots, was Bless the Lord.
Yes, and amen. We're going to have the whole cast on.
Mia Gentile.
Oh my God.
Mia, Small if you're world. Out there, can't wait to have you on the show.
Love her and Eric.
Julius, hi.
Julius is here.
You nailed that.
Love it. Good job, Garett. All right, Adam, the song from your past. It's number 1. Let's hear it. Take
it
away.
This is also going to be so bad, but not because I don't remember lyrics, because I haven't sung in years.
I hear the sound
whenever you talk. Whenever you walk, whenever you squawk, turned chin and that grin of impetuous youth. I only remember the beginning one.
Okay. That's fine.
Oh, I believe in you. I believe in you. And when I made through my fellow man, I'll just start doing the lyrics of Brotherhood of Man. You know, there is a brotherhood.
Oh my gosh.
Oh shit, you guys, that was so bad. That was horrible.
Where did you do that?
I did it with Ricky Hines at Flat Rock.
Amazing.
I mean, that's a great role for you. I'd love to see it.
Thank you. I don't remember it clearly. What I did learn from that show, though, was how to tie a bow tie without looking in the mirror, because like you had like these fake mirrors, and I had to like do this. So, pick that.
Special skills.
I taught myself how to tie a bow tie without looking in a mirror because I have a habit at weddings of wanting to untie my tie like while I'm on the dance floor, but then for pictures I want to retie it. So I know how to tie a bow tie without looking in a mirror while drunk on a dance floor. So Adam, we can stage a whole number together.
Thank you. Taylor Cash, you saw that show. She just commented.
Yes, throwback.
Throwback.
All right, boys. Well, Garett definitely took that round. So he's catching up from the Name That Diva round. And we're neck and neck going into round two here.
Which the theme for round two, okay, go with us on this. We were talking about Alan Menken earlier tonight. Mm-hmm. And we here at the MT Trivia love a good gender bending moment. So we are going to be doing an Alan Menken gender bender.
Woo! And boys, feel free to go down the octave, up the octave, whatever feels right.
Wait, so Alan Menken gender bender?
Yeah.
Alan Menken songs written for female identifying performers.
Thank you.
Okay. Am I going first again? Yes.
You are. You're in the big screen.
Oh, that's me. Okay. Oh God. Okay. I'm so nervous.
You scare.
Tomorrow and sleep. I look like Betty Crocker. Da,
da, da, da, da. Yes.
I'm washing the trailer. The garden magazine. And the pine soil scented air. Somewhere that's great. Looking for But that's 9:15. I look like Duty. I don't know this.
Yes. Yes, your Ellen Green is on point.
I also loved the like wide open vowel. Like that was it.
That's from Wicked for Froggy Fernie Cabbage. The baby is a naturally grand. A very specific placement we had to do for that.
He's got it.
I look like Hootie Doody.
I look like Hootie Doody. Let's hear it for that choice.
Right. Amazing. All right.
That was great, Garett.
We'll give you a point for that just because it's entertaining. You definitely get a
point. You get a point for all of those vocals for sure. Adam, let's hear your gender bender selection here.
Okay, it's number two. Oh, that's it.
Yeah.
But I have to know I still have a chance, and maybe I'll make a painful mistake. It's mine, though, to take or refuse. All the doors yet to open. All of the rooms ahead. Thank you to all my like college students singing this song. Bright, merry, and new. But I'm standing tall and I'm walking through. It's gone, maybe gone, but I won't go on playing dead.
Hold out.
I never.
Yes! Thank you for that perfectly placed Marla Mandel vibrato.
Yes.
Iconic.
Iconic.
Hi, Connie.
That's the CCM placement, Garett.
that trifecta.
You gotta get there. You got it. Adam, I love that you know all of the words to Life I Never Led, but not a role that you actually played on the stage.
Right. Sounds about right.
That tracks for sure. You definitely both get a point for that round. That was amazing. Neck and neck. And going into our final round here. So this is another one we like to do.
I don't have much faith in you two for this one.
This one's like, this is gonna be tricky. These are songs from shows that you've been in, but that you did not sing.
Oh no.
In the show. Like, were you listening to the monitor or were you on your phone backstage? Maybe you were on stage, who knows?
We're
about to find out. Were you paying attention? Garett Hawe, number 3. This is your final sing out, Louise. Take it away.
Sorry.
No. Okay. That would also qualify if you want. That's your lifeline right there, if you want.
That, I mean, those lyrics I do know for sure, but okay. Let's see. Okay. 3.
My pace is frantic. My temper's cross.
Oh, is this Mac and Mabel? La da 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 da. Just turn. Oh no. No. We have like 10 days of rehearsal for this.
You're welcome to use your lifeline, which is the other option that you almost played.
Da,
da,
da, da, da, da.
They want the lifeline. Garett, they want the lifeline.
They want the lifeline?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Douglas Sills gave a phenomenal performance. In I did not. All right. Lifeline.
Lifeline.
And I'll stand there with a wizard, feeling things I've never felt. And though I'd never show it, I'd be so happy I could melt. So it will be for the rest of my life. And I want nothing else till I die. Held in such high esteem. Oh my God, so low. See, they will scream for half of Oz's favorite team. Ah, the wizard. And it's done.
Yeah.
So for those of you who don't know, the wizard and I is our sound check every week so that we can test levels. And so we always offer our guests the lifeline of the wizard and I. Garett, I think you're the first person to take it.
I think so.
That was awesome.
First person to
thank you for your option.
That
yes.
And that first song was I Won't Send Roses from Mac and Mabel, which you did at Encores?
Yeah, the last time I performed on a stage, one year ago.
Yes.
Love that show.
Yeah, the score is incredible, actually.
Yeah, so fun.
Jerry Herman,
I know it better, though. But
I mean, 10 days is not a lot of time.
All right, Adam, our final Sing Out Louise, a song from a show you did that you did not sing. Let's see.
Shit. Okay.
I love you. Only make believe that you love me. And that's all I know the song. I don't know the rest. This rehearsal process also was a week. I don't know the words. Yeah, you guys, that's not fair. These were like,
wait, what is that? Oh no.
That was Showboat.
Oh yeah.
That's Make Believe from Showboat, which was another, Kevin, he really picked on two.
Okay, listen, normally when we
watch what happens, like,
here's the problem. So many things. Here's the dilemma I was in. Normally when we do this is this is where the gender bending happened, but I had already prepared the Alan Menken gender bending and I wasn't going to give you two gender benders. So I was like, well, let's just do a deep dive into the shows that they were in the ensemble of and only rehearsed for a week and a half. And
that is
see
so
how this
savage.
Goes.
Savage.
It was very savage. We probably should have ended with the girl songs. just, but you know,
it's fun to watch them squirm.
Oh,
well,
gosh.
You both killed it. Honey, you want to calculate?
I'm going to do some calculations. Kevin's going to remind you one more time the reason for the season.
The reason for the season is that we are raising money for Broadway for Racial Justice. So if you want to throw some tips, if you want to tip the boys for their fantastic performances tonight, you can Venmo at MT-trivia. And 100% of those tips will go to Broadway for Racial Justice, who are doing the good work to bring equity to the Broadway community at large. They were in Newsies.
I had no idea. Boys, this was an amazing episode. It was very close, and I'm just gonna have to say that you're both winners, baby.
My dog just like woke up from that.
Oh, come here. Who's that?
That, of course, is Carolee Carmello, who we like to end every show with her belting. And yes, Carolee Carmello has been known to even the dogs go wild for her.
Woo!
So, boys.
Ralph's not here, otherwise I would grab Ralph.
Boys, thank you so much for playing with us. We had a blast. We hope you did too.
Oh my gosh, this was so much fun. I'm coming undone here, but I had to bring Toby in for the final moment.
Had to get Toby. Garett, thanks for sharing your dog. Adam, please send our love to Ralph.
I will.
Thank you both so much. You're both stars in our eyes.
We'll see you soon.
And winners, baby.
Oh, what a show.
All right, Toby, a show. And guess what? There is more coming your way. If you had fun tonight, check out all of the offerings of the Broadway Talk Live Network, starting with tomorrow night's Good Morning Tonight at 7 o'clock with Michael Hull and Jackie Cox. Their guests tomorrow are Andy Mantis, Vasti Mompoint, and Conrad Riccamora.
Ooh, how fun. And then on Thursday at 5:30, we have the 5:30 Quarantini Broadway Happy Hour with Michael Hull and Dylan Bustamante, and they have the dreamy puppeteer Barrett Foa from Avenue Q and all the other things. We love Barrett Foa. We're so excited.
And we will be back next Monday night at 9 o'clock. And our guests, ooh, got a little chilly in here.
I'm getting a little
from
I feel
the
a
Broadway
the
company of Frozen. It's Ashley Blanchett and Lauren Nicole Chapman. Ooh. They will be with us playing some trivia. So
we are so excited to have the girls here next week. And we will see you then, 9 o'clock next Monday.
See you then.
Bye.